son, Jesus, who initiated. What does that tell you about God? Who?
He's got it.
He's got it. What does that tell you about us?
We respond.
We respond. I had this conversation with my brother. Do you want in? Okay. I had this conversation with my brother yesterday. Steve has a daughter who is let's just say, wandering far afield. And he said, Abby's just not interested in anything about God, Jesus, anything. And I said to him, Steve, you know, we were dead in our transgressions and sin, and dead people can't do anything for themselves, only Jesus can. So, same thing with all these covenants, right? We were far afield, we were dead in our transgressions and sin, and God initiates. All the time, God initiates. Okay, so, with every covenant, we've had a sacrifice. So, when did Noah have a sacrifice? After the flood, then did they have a meal? Yeah, you have to eat your sacrifice, otherwise it's a waste. And then what happened from there? They just know. What did God give it? Yeah, the sign. What does the sign point to? Sign points to a promise. Next covenant, Abraham. Was there a sacrifice? Yes. Was there a meal?
Yes.
Was there a sign?
Yes.
What was the sign? What does the sign point to? The promise. What is the promise for Abraham? Yeah, sign points to promise. Moses, was there a sacrifice? Do you remember when Moses came down from the mountain? What did he do? Yeah, where did he get the blood? From the sacrifice. Was there a meal? Was there a sign? Same sign, different sign. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I would say that probably for Moses, the sign is the same as Abraham because they're still under that generational process. So again, what does the sign point to? The promise. What is the promise? Land? What else? Okay, y'all have to talk to me. Bless through them. What's the next promise? What's the next covenant? Jesus. Was there a sacrifice?
Yes.
Was there a meal?
Yes.
Passover meal. Was there a sign? What does Jesus say at the Passover supper with his disciples? This is my? This is my? What are the emblems? What are the signs? Bread and wine. What do they point to? The promise of what? His return. This we will do, and I will not do it again until we have it in the kingdom of heaven. Which that would be an amazing communion service. Okay. Here we're gonna go way back. So if you want to go back to all the way to the beginning of your book, what is the definition of the Hebrew word for covenant? Bro, I literally had to listen to the, yeah, the guy say it 100 times and I'm still not sure. I did too. What does the word bereaved mean? Does it imply a sacrifice? Yes. Pass between. So we're separating, right? Separating. What does the word karith mean? So that's the next page over. Also Hebrew.
To cut.
To cut. So implication, separating, right? Now I want you to follow me on this. The word holy at its root means to separate. So God is holy because he is separate. So we have a covenant that is showing us by a picture separate. And God is holy because he is separate. So when you read through the Ten Commandments, then it informs your process. So with a, you shall not take the Lord, the name of the Lord your God, in vain, right? Why? Because he's holy, because he's separate. So the first five commandments of the Ten all talk about responses to who God is because he is separate. He is different. He is completely separate from us. So we are going to go through 2 weeks worth, good luck to us, which this is hilarious. I don't know who did this, but it's questions about the Ten Commandments. Must have been Brad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so all the way through. We're going to go through Genesis, and you're going to think, oh my golly, how do we do this again? But my guess is you will never forget Genesis 12 to 19, right? Don't know it. So starting at Genesis 12, Genesis 12. Look at it, and I need you to tell me what is going on. Genesis 12, 1 to 5-ish, 1 to 4-ish. What is it, what's happening, etc. Who came to who?
God came to Abram.
Where was Abram? And what nationality was Abram? Right, so what nationality is Abram? This is going to, I'm gonna hammer this on you.
Because you knew me.
Yeah, so he was Arabic. He was, although that really wasn't a thing back then, but he was he was actually in the area of Babylon. So would he have any idea about one true God? No. So when the God of the universe interrupts Abram's life, he has no context for this. Because the gods of Babylon, do they talk? Do they move? Do they interact? I just was reading in Psalms just yesterday. Psalms 115 says this: why should the nations say, where is their God? Their idols are silver and gold, the work of human hands. They have mouths, they don't speak. Eyes, they don't see. Ears, they don't hear. Noses, they don't smell. Hands, don't feel. Feet, don't walk. They do not make a sound in their throat. Those who make them become like them. And so do all who trust him. Psalm 115. That's the world that Abram came from. That they had man-made idols that they were praying to, thinking. that idols that they made could help them do something. And the God of the universe interrupts Abram's life and says, what?
Genesis 2.
Yeah, okay. How many people are going away? Blessing, particularly,
he's gonna get the land.
What kind of yin for yang does he get in verse 3? And what kind of protection does he get? Yeah, so if you do this, I will protect you. How old were they?
75.
Okay. I'm not 75, but I'm thinking if God interrupts my life at 75 and says, take everything and go to a place and the people that you do not know, I would have some questions. And what does Abram do?
He doesn't.
So what does that tell you about Abram? What does it tell you about God? What does that tell you about our relationship to God?
Trustworthy.
What does that tell you about how he wants to use you in his kingdom work?
It doesn't have to be with our works per se or who we think we are.
Right.
It's up to God.
It's up to God. Okay. Cement this in your brain. How old was Abram the first time God interrupted his life?
75.
Does he have any kids?
No.
Is there any good reason why a 75 and a 65-year-old should expect children?
No.
Go to Genesis 15. God then interrupts Abram's life again, 1-6. What's his name still? Abram. And he says, okay, I gave you the big idea several years ago. Now I'm going to flesh it out a little bit more. How does he flesh it out? Abram, did he say, I'll believe it when I see it? Which would be my response.
He believed the Lord.
He believed the Lord, and what did the Lord grant to him as a result?
Righteousness.
Was Abram declared righteous by the fact that he moved to Canaan? What was Abram's righteousness solely based on? Believed the Lord. Faith. A noun and a verb. He heard it. He believed it. He acted on it. What is in Genesis 15, 13? What, tell me what the time frame is. What do What is God telling Abram in 15:13? What's the time frame? 400 years. Okay, we kind of gloss over that. What is this year? Subtract 430 years. What year are we? Boy, that'll tax your brain. So you can use your calculator on your phone. Okay, be easy. 400 years. What year is that? 1622. Do you happen to know what happened? Well, let's rephrase that. Was the U.S. a country in 1622? What happened in 1622 for anybody who happens to be a history person? Nobody's a history person.
The massacre of Jamestown.
1622, when the first people came over from England and were having whatever, and they were massacred. 1622, okay. Those people, internet, no. Electricity, no. Gas, no. Anything, no. 400, if somebody had said to them, I'm going to promise you in 400 years, the reaction would probably have been, am I going to be alive? Abram receives his promise, and he has no way of seeing the end of his promise. Abram is going through the process. Genesis 17. You know what? Genesis 16. What's the big story here? What?
He decides to have the baby.
Yeah, who decides?
Well, Sarah.
Sarah decides, which that's awkward, but okay.
Common,
yes, but still awkward. What's the result?
Ishmael.
How old was Sarah then?
80.
Yeah, so, well, Abram was 85, so Sarah is how old? When did they receive the promise? Yeah, so 10 years ago. They're tired of waiting. You told me it's been 10 flipping years. I'm going to do something. I'm going to help you along. So she helped, and Ishmael is born. Who is Ishmael?
Hagar and Abram's son.
And in the big world picture, who is Ishmael? Ishmael is the father of many nations, all of which are current enemies of Israel. So, Ishmael is the father of all the Arab nations. Ishmael is the father of the Egyptian nations. Because Sarah is not willing to wait on God's faithfulness and God's promise, she concocts her own conclusion, she concocts her own solution, and we have a problem. So, the obvious question then is, what does that tell you about God? Does he allow us to make our own choice, even though he has promised, right? Has that altered his promise?
No.
No. But there's a consequence.
I have a question. If Abram was so, I don't know, obedient, why did he listen to her, I guess? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. I know what you mean. I think that Abram is characterized by obedience. And remember that Abram was not counted righteous because of what he did. he was counted righteous because he believed. Okay, so the word believe means to put my full weight on something. So I am completely trusting that this chair is going to hold me up. I'm not sitting in the chair and making sure I'm holding on to something else, waiting for it to collapse. So when it says that Abram believed God, it's saying that Abram put his full weight into what God said. If you read Abram's story, you can see several times that he got tripped up by his own solutions. So what does that tell you about how God interacts with you? He allow consequence in our lives, but does he remove his promise from our life? No. So God is separate. God is holy. God is a promise keeper who delights in keeping his promises. He made a promise to Abram, not contingent on anything that Abram did, only what he believed. Genesis 17. How old is Abram? 99. How many years?
15.
Hmm? 15 ish. 99 minus 75. How many years between 99 and 75? 24! Abram's going through the process. What does that tell you about God?
It's his promises, but it's his time. He's got it.
Yeah. Uh-huh. What are we called to do? Receive promises from God. What is your call in relationship to God? What does that tell you about your relationship to God?
I'm not sure what your question is, but what is our call?
So,
you mean what is our position?
What do we do when we say, I believe it, you have promised me this, but I don't see anything.
My call is to stand.
To stand.
To do nothing but stand on the promises of God, no matter what I see, no matter what I feel, no matter what happens.
It's an old hymn, standing on the promises of God, my King. Mm-hmm. Through eternal ages, let his praises sing.
Mm-hmm.
Abram and Sarah made a mistake and had Hagar. So, in Genesis 17, what's the storyline? Yep, circumcised. In Genesis 17, what happens to their names? Names changed. Did Abraham obey the call to circumcision? Fully or partially? Had he seen the outcome of the promise yet? No. But he was still fully obedient. I love this part. Look in Genesis 17, 15, and 16. So tell me what God said about Sarah in Genesis 17, verses 15 and 16.
I will bless her.
Yep. Is there any sort of recrimination in these verses for Sarah? No. Sarah's the one that concocted Hagar and Ishmael. She made a kind of cataclysmic error in judgment. But God's response in Genesis 17 about Sarah is what? I'm changing her name. I'm honoring her by changing her name. I'm going to bless her. I'm going to elevate her. She's going to have kings and nations coming from her. Tell me what you learn about God because of that. He's faithful. He's forgiving. What else? Say louder.
I like redeeming your mistakes.
Yeah. So all of a sudden we have a God that says, yes, this was wrong, but I'm not holding it against you. There will be consequences because of that. Sarah probably didn't see that, but her offspring did. But I'm going to redeem, I'm going to restore, I'm going to bless abundantly. Now, what does that tell you about your relationship with God?
Well, thank goodness he's going to forgive me, and then he's going to bless me too.
Yeah. He's going to bless you according to Ephesians 1 with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Is he going to hold our sin, our error, our misjudgment, our whatever against us? No. Consequence? Yeah. Could be. What does God say to the Israelites about that? He said to the Israelites early on, judgment may be on your children to the third and fourth generation, but my blessing will be upon generations uncounted. So what does that tell you about God?
He wants to bless us.
He wants to bless us.
It is the consequence that he gives us to smash us into oblivion. What is the consequence for?
Discipline.
What is the root word of discipline? Disciple. What is the meaning of to disciple?
To teach.
To teach so that you can grow. I was a piano teacher for way too many years to come. 32 students every year. When I taught them, there were times I said, great job, you practiced well this week. We're going to go on to the next thing. And at the time, I was like, dang, what did you do this week? We're going to do the same thing this week. It's a process of discipleship. It's a process of teaching. And that's what God does for us in our lives. You were fully obedient. Now we're going to go on to the next thing that you're going to learn. Not, yippee, we're fully obedient. Your life's going to be happy clappy. no process. Genesis 21. Actually, Genesis 18:14. Somebody read that, just that first phrase.
Is anything too hard for the Lord?
Ooh, what does it tell you about God? Is there anything that God cannot do? If you ever want to have a kind of a sit-down moment with God, read the book of Job, chapters 40 to 42 or 3. And God talks to Job, and he's like, where were you when I created? Where were you when I made the sunrise? Where? This is what I do. About Sarah, is there anything too hard for me? Which is a rhetorical question, by the way, because the obvious answer is no. So Genesis 21, what happens?
Isaac is born.
Baby's born. How old was Sarah? How old was Abraham? How many years between the promise and the fulfillment? 25 years. What does that tell you about God? Ain't that the truth? What does that tell you about his commitment to his promise? He will keep his promises. What does that tell you about our response to his promise? We can hold firm. You can sit in that chair and lift your feet up and fully rest. You can put your full weight in his promises. Because God who promises is faithful. God is a promise keeper who delights in keeping his promises. So then we have this really weird interruptive clause for Genesis 22. What happens? God, who promised Isaac, says to Abram, what, and what? Okay, you skipped a phrase. Oh. Take your son, what?
Your own son.
Who, what? Whom you love. So tell me everything that you learned about Abram and Isaac in that sentence.
Only son.
Only son. Relationship.
Loving.
Loving. Take your son. Remember, God promised, out of your own body you will have a son. And do what? Offer him as a what kind of offering? A burnt? We kind of genericize this whole process because we say, which is bad enough, sacrifice your son Isaac. But this is a burnt offering. So the God of the universe, who Abram just had waited 25 years to have, and then there's probably 13 or 16 more years on top of this, God's saying, take your son, your only son, whom you love, and offer him as a great sacrifice. Jackie Hill Perry had a really fascinating take on this. I just sort of saw it inadvertently this week. What kind of culture did Abram say he was from? Did I say Abram was from? Arab. What did he worship? Idols. And she said, the God of the universe, remember we talked about he's holy, therefore he's separate, may be testing Abram's commitment to leaving the idolatry behind. Take your son, your only son, whom you love. Are you going to hold on to Isaac more than me? That's the definition of idolatry. Anything that I put above God is an idol. Any priority that I put above God is an idol. And she said, God could very well have been saying to Abram, who is your priority? Me or Isaac? So therefore, here's my question. This is a test for Abram. For whose benefit was this test?
Abram.
Who else? Isaac. What did they both learn? God would provide. Let's just leave it right there. God takes you through a test. When you are in first grade, second grade, and all the way through whatever you graduated to, you took many tests. And the teacher handed you a test. Was it for her benefit or yours? It's I received the test. So I could know what? What did the test reveal?
What I know.
And if I have conquered the work, when you are, if you're a first grader and the teacher says, you probably need to repeat first grade again, what does she say? The work has not been conquered. When God tests you, and he does, for whose benefit is it? For our benefit. So that we will know what we've learned. If I have conquered this test, does that mean there are no more tests in front of me? No. The purpose of graduating first grade is to do what? Go to second grade. And the purpose of graduating second grade is to go to third grade. Do the tests get more difficult? Yes. For what purpose? For our good. So I can graduate. So I can take what I have learned and use it. So God tests us for the purpose of showing us what we have learned about him. Because frankly, there's no point in passing a test if you're not going to use it. My piano students every year had a recital, which they hated. But it was for the purpose of taking what they had learned and using it. And that's what God does. He takes, he teaches us, and we're expected to use it. Abram was given a promise, and he had to walk through 25 years and wait for the promise. Now, here's what I want you to do at your tables. Ready? So somebody gets to be a scribe. I'm giving you several questions. First question is, why was Abram counted righteous? What did the covenant promise rest on? What does the law bring? And how was Abram and Sarah described when they received the promise? And you're going to get this from Romans 4. Mm-hmm. ready? Why was Abram counted righteous? Was Abram counted righteous because of circumcision? Sorry, I just added that one. What did the covenant promise rest on? And then we'll just skip to how were Abram and Sarah described. Okay, so Romans 4, it's 22 verses. So I'll give you 10 minutes. I'll be back.